Thank you very much, and also for the invitation to be here. I hope nobody of you came because of the abstract that I sent to Marek some time ago. He asked me for an abstract of my presentation, first of all for the title, and then for an abstract, and I sent him something, and already the day afterward I said, well, this is not correct. But as I realized that one day later it would still be a different story, I didn't send any other abstract anymore. So the title is not correct and the abstract is not correct. But I will talk about legal imagination. And actually, I will argue, that was also my original intention, I will argue that imagination plays no serious role in law, neither in the explanation of legal judgments nor in the justification. And since that these two are the only two roles I can imagine, no role at all. That's also what I more or less sent to Marek. And then after one day I thought, this is not correct. And then 2 days later, I thought, yes, but maybe it's still correct. So what I'm trying to do in my presentation now is to explain why I'm so confused. And of course, I expect from all of you that you help me out of my confusion. I start with a quotation which, at least for philosophers, is quite familiar. It's one by Otto Neurath, one member of the Vienna Circle. Es gibt keine tabula rasa. Wie schiefer sind wir, die ihr schief auf offener See umbauen müssen, ohne es jemals in einem Dock zerlegen und aus besten Bestandteilen neu errichten zu können. Or in plain English, well, more or less plain. We are like people who have to rebuild a ship while sailing with a ship on full sea. You cannot change everything at the same time. So you cannot put it down and make it the best way you wanted to. You always have to live with where you are. Exactly, this is the predicament I was wrestling with. Because I had the feeling halfway in my presentation that this was not going the right way, but since everything was uncertain, I didn't know what to change and what not to change. But I'm relying on you to solve all my problems. What I will do is I first mention two functions of legal imagination, of course, which I then will later deny that they exist. I say a little bit about embodied simulation, but not very much. Then I'll give you an argument from epiphenomenalism why legal imagination is not relevant for explanation of legal behavior. And since it's not relevant for justification, not relevant at all. Maybe that problem can be remedied by stepping to an identity theory of mind and brain. I say a little bit about the role of functionalism and about the attribution of causality. And that's where the problem comes in. Because as soon as you start to think about causality, it's not so clear what it is. Causality plays an essential role in my argument, and since it's unclear, the value of the argument starts to crumble. And that's where I need you. So that's more or less the presentation as it will be. So what are the functions of imagination in law? This I take more or less from Bartosz's new book. So this is not either the blame, but also the value of what is said here is on Bartosz. I think the value. So what lawyers sometimes do is they try to, when they have to deal with a particular case, they have to solve it, they try to imagine and get a fifth picture or image of what's going on, and then they more or less feel how to decide the case. You might call it a feeling of justice or whatever. Anyway, they have a kind of feeling about how the case should be solved. And later they may produce an argument, but this first initial feeling about what is the right solution for this is important. And imagining a case absolutely plays a role in it, at least, so it seems. So that would be one function. Another function is when you are not very sure how to deal with the case, and then you try to make mental variations. So you imagine the case, and you imagine a number of similar cases for which you intuitively feel how they should be dealt with. And then you try to figure out what are the relevant similarities and the relevant differences, and then you have to take a decision. Are the differences more important, or are the similarities more important? Of course, if the similarities are more important, you can follow your intuitions about the similar cases. If the differences are more important, you should explain why the actual case should be dealt with in a different way. So also there, he seemed to use a kind of imagination, but now not only imagination about the actual case, but also about similar cases. Okay, until now it seems clear that's how most lawyers feel they operate, including me. But perhaps the feeling is not correct. So I want to take a step back, and say a little bit about mental images and embodied cognition. So what we have when you imagine something is a conscious representation or a mental image. That's why I checked this morning with Bartosz, do you really mean it's conscious? And then I assume there is a brain state underlying or embodying the mental image. You see in between those two levels both an arrow and an identity sign, because the relation here is somewhat ambiguous. Does the brain state cause the conscious representation or the mental image? Or does it, and that's even vaguer, embody it? And embodying is meant to express that it might be the similar thing under a different name. Philosophers amongst you will recognize epiphenomenalism and the identity theory about the relation between mind and brain here. What I think is important, that if there's a brain state underlying the conscious representation, this brain state also has to indicate whether it was based on observation, on memory, or imagination. We think of all those things as causing a brain state, but the brain state itself, to the extent that it represents a mental image, does not tell you whether it's an observation, a memory, or an imagination. Actually, we know that more or less the same parts are used for observation, for memory, and imagination, at least for the mental image. So somehow, the brain also has to represent some information about where the image came from. Observation, memory, or imagination, and perhaps psychologists can help me finding even more origins. So I think this is an addition to what the proper mental image is. What I see when I read psychological literature, that people write, for instance, well, imagination use the system for perception, for instance, for visual perception, for representing the mental image, suggesting that the visual system is what the brain really does, and all the other things are more or less derived. Well, I was thinking, well, if some part of the brain is used both in conscious mental images from observation, from memory, and from imagination, the brain state, to the extent that it realizes a mental image, is more or less detached from its origin. Of course, it has an origin, but if you want to distinguish the two, something else must be available in the brain, namely a tag where it derives from. This is important for me because of what is a sidetrack, but apparently I can use quite some time for it. Some of you know that I've been working on epistemology, and in particular about coherentism. I don't know whether you are all familiar with epistemology. That's more or less a theory about how we justify our knowledge and what knowledge exists or can be justified. And a classical idea epistemology is, well, all knowledge is based on some foundation, and empiricists like to say, okay, we have sensory perceptions, and in the end, that's the foundation of everything. The problem is that, well, if you start, everything can be criticized, even empirical knowledge and observations, because you never know that what you observe is really true in the actual world. Of course, you see it, but that's your theory. So one reason to abolish traditional foundationalism is to see, all criticism of theory is based on another theory. So what you have in your mind is only theories. And of course, you believe of some of those theories that they are about the real world. Well, actually, that was this picture. You have a mental state or a brain state. And then, if you think it's an observation, you have an additional tag, observation, which is also in your brain. So it's not that you have more or less immediate picture of the world around you, what empiricists sometimes like to think, although not all of them, not Popper, for instance. You have something more. if you think that some brain state is about, or some mental state is about, an external reality. That led me to the following theory about coherence. We have a number of object-level beliefs. For instance, the window is open, there are cars in the street, and I'm hungry. And then you have a number of meta-beliefs, which are also beliefs. For instance, meta-belief 1 is about belief A, and it states that belief A is based on observation, with the suggestion that it is objective, because it's an external state of affairs. Belief B, on the contrary, is a memory. And belief C is a belief that should be maintained under belief revision. So if you think that there's a problem somewhere, belief 3 says, well, you can change lots of things, but you cannot change belief C. Unless, of course, you first revise belief 3. This is nothing to do with psychology or whatever. This is a theory about coherence and what a good coherent theory should be. But it has direct links to this story with the idea that brain states or mental images or mental states, you might call it what you want, have something added to them, which I would call meta-knowledge, which states where they're stemming from. So there is no direct access to an external reality. Everything goes via brain states, but it's not the case that there's an immediate link from an external world to a brain state or a mental image. You have mental images with accompanying brain states saying that those images are images of an external world and therefore objectively true. Of course, those are theories too. So, that is background. Well, here starts the criticism. I used to be, and I think I still am, with lots of doubts which come later, an epiphenomenalist. Epiphenomenalism is a theory about the relation between brain states, physical states, and mental states. And this theory makes a sharp distinction between brain states and mental states. Brain states cause, and I put it between quotes because I have doubts about the notion of causation, but brain states, according to this view, cause mental states, but not the other way around. So it's one-way traffic. Brain states are connected in a causal chain, but there is no mental causation. So the mental aspect of the story has no influence on what happens. Then you have something like the following picture, of course, highly simplistic. So we have brain state 1. Brain state 1 goes together with, or better, causes a mental state. Brain state 1, as a brain state, is part of a causal chain, and that causal chain may lead to a change, the next brain state 2, which goes together with another mental state. But notice that there are no arrows between the mental states, neither in between themselves nor back to the brain state. So mental states as such do not have any impact on your brain and not any impact on each other. The only thing which happens, a causal change, only exists between brain states. Again, this is what I would like to believe, but which I hardly can believe. The problem is that the alternatives are even worse. So this is a relatively simplistic picture, which has been popular for some time, but it's not so popular anymore because most people prefer a kind of identity theory. But the argument from epiphenomenalism against the role of mental states is the following. Imagination is by definition a mental phenomenon. Since there is no mental causation, so mental phenomena has no causal influences whatsoever, you cannot use mental states in any explanation. And therefore, legal imagination cannot cause, and therefore also cannot explain anything. It's nice, but the explanation should be done by the underlying brain state, not by the imagination as such. I will come to some objections later. Okay, so there is no explanatory role for mental states, including for legal imagination. A year ago, I have argued that those mental states cannot justify legal judgments either, but actually hardly anybody wants to claim that what you imagine can justify anything. So I think that doesn't need much justification itself. So legal imagination does not play any role in explaining something. It does not play any role in justifying something, let alone legal judgments. So legal imagination is completely irrelevant. Contrary to the two examples of use of legal imagination which I gave. If this theory is correct, those stories about case comparison and about legal intuitions which justify things or play a role, nice story, but you have to do everything in terms of brain states underlying the mental states. The mental states as such cannot do anything. Well, that sounds nice, but people have objected, well, you must realize that those brain states do not cause mental states, they are just the same thing, but described in different kinds of terminology. So you have something, you can describe it in terms of causes and effects, and neurons, and chemical reactions, and electricity, etc. Nice, but you can also describe it in terms of beliefs, desires, and a motivational theory of beliefs and desires, like Hume's, etc. So you can describe the same thing on different levels. The different descriptions just represent different aspects of the same thing. And then, it seems, the mental states, but then under a different description, play a role in causational change, and they can be used to explain something. Then you would have the following picture. We have four mind-brain states, and they have at least two aspects. I ignore all the rest. So the black part is the physical aspect, brain states. And then we have a red part, it's just the mental state, but essentially they are the same thing. And since they are the same things, and since there can be causal relation between physical states, there can be causal relations between mind-brain states. So, problem solved, it seems. So, it seems that the mind-brain state can figure in causal explanations, but the problem is that the causal laws must be formulated in terms of the brain aspect of those states, at least, if you want to stick to the physicalist paradigm, of course, you don't have to do that. So one obvious kind of criticism of what I'm doing here is we shouldn't stick to this physicalist paradigm. Okay, that's for you to do that later. I think there may be something to be said there. Legal imagination is a mental aspect of the mind-brain states, and then it seems a bit strange that the causal connections which play a role in the physical parts of those states also play a role in the mental states. In a sense it seems possible, but it sounds weird. And I think the problem is the following. It has to do with functionalism. Functionalism is not an alternative theory in connection with mind-brain relation. It's more or less a way of looking at brain states and specifying brain states not in physical terms, but in functional terms. So it's the brain state of realizing vision or realizing desire or realizing whatever. You describe parts of the brain as the relevant part of the brain for performing this or that function. But if you, those brain states, as defined in functionalist terms, do they really play a role in causal laws? I can imagine causal laws between electrons, physical, chemical phenomena, etc. But are there also physical laws about brain parts of the brain which are specified in a functionalist way? I doubt it. And if that is really doubtful, though we still don't have solved the problem of the causal relation between mental states, and we still have the problem that mental states as such cannot be used in any causal explanation or whatever kind of explanation. So the simple, and what I added later, the simplistic conclusion is that legal imagination neither plays a role in the explanation nor in the justification of legal judgments. So the story about the explanation essentially remains the same as in the epiphenomenalist story. We try to remedy it by means of an identity theory in combination with functionalism. That doesn't work, so it seems. Justification still seems irrelevant. So here is where it stops. By the way, I continue later. By the way, I forgot to mention, feel free to interrupt. it's so obvious for me, but I notice that you're also silent, that I'm almost getting nervous from it. So maybe this is a good point to say, from you have it all wrong. And then later I'll say, yes, you're right. But please feel free to object that I completely misrepresented everything, etc. That is nonsense what I said. So if anybody, please defend that mental states can play a role in the explanation of legal decision making, whatever. Yes.
But I don't agree with you. In this main thesis, that it's, but in my opinion, legal imagination play fundamental role in legal explanation and justification as a starting point. And of course, I don't want to discuss about this idea. We have many others, like legal understanding, legal pre-understanding, legal instinct, legal intuition, legal insight. For me, it's almost the same. But I am lawyer, not only philosopher, I am lawyer. And I am really very active in praxis. And I say, without this legal imagination, intuition, or I don't know, pre-understanding, I cannot solve the hard case. And because of this, for me, is if I cannot find this imagination, if I cannot have this imagination, I cannot start with this interpretation. Of course, we discuss about hard cases, not about this simple, but I would like to say that this interpretation is interesting, but for easy case, algorithmic case. Mm-hmm. In this, I say, okay, I agree with you. But if I have a fundamental problem, existential problem, really very difficult interpretation, then I need something like legal imagination or something similar, but it's only a problem of definition.
Yeah, no, I agree with it. So let's lump all the mental phenomena together under the heading of legal imagination. I agree with you, it doesn't matter whether we call it intuition or imagination, then you may make subtle distinctions, but that's not the issue. My point would be about all mental states as opposed to physical states. And I agree with you in the sense that if I'm trying to solve legal problems, and sometimes I do that, I also have the strong feeling that I'm using intuition, my feeling of justice, and all those things. So when we're talking about how we experience things, I completely agree with you. My problem is that at the same time, we have a way of looking at science and at causation, etc., and all those things, and those two things do not match. There seems to be an incoherence between our physicalist way of looking at brain and the assumption that brains, perhaps extended brains with the rest of your body, or even physical devices outside the brain, but nevertheless physical things more or less determine everything, and there are causal chains between physical things. And the idea that those physical states must somehow determine the mental states. This basic idea behind epiphenomenology, that is not compatible with the idea that those mental things make us take particular distinctions and we need them. And then several ways of looking at it of solving this problem can be used. You can stick to the mental solution and say, okay, apparently this physicalist paradigm is incorrect. It works very well for physical phenomena, but apart from physical phenomena, we have other phenomena in which mental states play a crucial role. So let's stick to that. And then we have to just abandon this physicalist paradigm. The problem is that it works very well for a lot of domains. And why would it certainly stop? Moreover, there is more and more research in cognitive psychology showing that how we experience our decision-making process is not a proper reflection of what actually goes on. We sometimes can predict which decision people make, and then we ask them, why did you do it? And they give completely different reasons. Then it seems that people don't have complete access to what motivates them. So the idea that we should stick to those mental representations is not as strong as it might seem.
Do you equate mental representations with consciousness or not?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, so, but you can have mental states that are not conscious, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So if I propose a thought experiment in which I'm going to influence your mental states, so or at least I have two groups of subjects, and there's one case that they have to judge, but beforehand I give them a set of cases that they read before they make the decision, and then I give different cases to the different groups, and my prediction will be they will respond differently because that prior information
influences them. Yes.
And so, but then you would say, no, that's not possible because those are.
No, I think that's very well possible, but people don't realize how they were influenced.
Okay.
So people don't maybe they have conscious phenomena there, but those conscious phenomena do not determine what they will be doing.
Okay. So then. But you are open to the idea of priming that I
yes, absolutely.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
No, actually, I think that what I'm presently saying does hardly contradicts any modern finding in cognitive sciences, apart from what I will be doing later. But no, because I already warned you, this is what I would like to believe.
Okay.
But I will give you a little bit away because I have some problems too, because it has to do with the nature of causation. But maybe Bartosz will do that already for me.
I just want to reply to your request. I want to say that you've got it all wrong.
Yes. I think so too, by the way, but...
Because legal imagination is not the mental state. It's our ability to produce, not images, because if we say imagination, it's one modality only. In truth, the mental simulations of multimodal. So they involve all kinds of things, including emotions, which connect us to what we call unconscious intuition and so on and so on. And now, this is one point in which I strongly disagree. I wouldn't say that imagination, when we speak of explaining something with imagination, we are speaking of explaining something. Showing how an ability to imagine something explains our...
Does the ability explain something or the actual exercise of the ability?
So this is my second point. Because there are two ways of conceiving explanation. So one is the nomological one, the other is the mechanistic one. The simple way of understanding it is that on everyday basis we understand or can explain a lot of things without citing a general law. We just know the mechanism behind, well, the fact that
it falls down.
And
yes.
So I do not have to use the law of gravity to explain. I just say, okay, I pushed it and it broke down. Mm-hmm. And now, I think that we explain the way lawyers think, the way they arrive at their decisions, by uncovering the mechanism they use to do it. And if we understand imagination in this way, okay, the third point, this was extremely abstract. And this is what philosophers do, and what I also do, try to provide such an abstract theory that, it cannot be defeated in one way or another.
Oh, this can be defeated, don't worry.
Consider a particular example. So for instance, if I was to teach criminal law and explain to my students what guilt is, I can provide them with a very abstract definition that a mens rea, guilty mind, whatever, is this, and that. But I can also do another thing. I can describe particular situations. So they would mentally simulate the situations in which someone, according to some previous decision or according to the prevailing theory, is guilty or is not guilty. What I do in this way is I educate their intuitions. So once they consider 100 different cases of guilt and 100 different, very similar cases of not being guilty, then they have what I would say an intuitive ability to judge the next case.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was saying too.
So in this way we uncover a mechanism which shows how our ability to imagine things can help us to form another ability to intuitively judge the cases. So this is one aspect of the story. So this is why I believe that you got it all wrong. I'm just playing the game.
It's okay. So, okay, as you can see already, page back to the very first slide, because what you start to do, and I think this was unavoidable, is to move slightly away to a new topic. This is not, it's unavoidable, so I think you're doing the right thing. So you have already moved to a theory about explanation in order to deal with this problem about epiphenomenalism or identity theory. Apparently the answer there, and you might disagree there, I'm not sure yet, but it depends on a theory about the nature of explanation. So all things hang together, and you cannot solve one problem without dealing with another problem, and here the other problem is, what is explanation? Okay, sorry, I have no slides about it, at least not here. Well, okay, I'm not going to look it up, whether I have that lecture here. Anyway, I think there are two, explanation is essentially a way to create understanding. And there are, let's say at least two ways to do so. One demanding way and an undemanding way, and something in between with mechanisms. The undemanding way is just tell a nice story, and if somebody ends with it, yes, now I understand it, you have created understanding, and that way you have explained what happened. For instance, I gave you, you might, for instance, I was taught a story about how the Dutch people became independent. They fought the tyrant from Spain, and then at the end, after a long war of 80 years, they finally succeeded in shaking off the yoke of the Spanish tyrant, and then they were an independent and free people. And we had the hero, the Prince of Orange, who did this all this for the Dutch people. Nice story, and I believed it when I was in primary school. That is a so-called narrative, and after the narrative, my feeling from, okay, how did these people get independent was gone. I had no problem with, now I understood what was going on. Of course, as you understand, narratives only provide a very shallow form of understanding, but psychologically speaking, you have at least a feeling that you understand things, and in some sense of understanding, you have understanding. At the other extreme, you have, by and large, the Hempel-Oppenheim model of explanation and the corresponding idea of understanding with the law without any exceptions, and then you have a deductively valid argument from facts of a case and laws, etc. And then you have in-between variants with a mechanism. I have a theory about mechanisms, maybe that goes a little bit far here, but actually I think a mechanism is a one-sided nomological deductive model. So you look at only one factor, and if that factor is present, then you can, looking back, okay, here we have a phenomenon. This law might have explained it, so this is the mechanism. Of course, if the phenomenon had not occurred, you would have needed a different law, and that makes it somewhat weaker than a full nomological deductive explanation. But the mechanism is essentially the same model, but what I call myopic. You only look at one particular factor. Since the effect came about, this factor must have been the cause.
There is a difference between explanation and understanding.
Yes.
Because if I had, well, you know, David Hilbert in the 1920s, had those lectures in Hamburg, and he was speaking about the word equation. So he wanted to have one equation from which everything would follow about, so you can predict everything. This would be a perfect explanation. But it would be something almost no one would understand. So understanding is not the same. So I may have a set of very universal laws, like, well, we have, I don't know, general theory of gravity. But almost no one understands, I mean, statistically speaking, almost no one understands it, but almost everyone understands what happens when things fall down. So the fact that we have a good explanation, it doesn't mean that we have a good understanding.
No, that's right. Explanation is a tool to get understanding, but a good explanation doesn't guarantee understanding.
Yeah.
On the other hand, you can have understanding without having a good explanation, as the narratives, which are very popular nowadays, illustrate. A narrative is absolutely not a good explanation in my understanding, and it leads to a kind of understanding in the sense, yes, people have the feeling, now I understand what's going on, their minds are satisfied. Actually, I defined it in a book which has still to appear, as the absence of cognitive dissonance. So, okay, yeah, the restlessness of your mind, there's something wrong here, has gone, you have the feeling it's okay, in that sense you have understanding. So, but if you, for instance, really understand Hilbert's equation, most people don't. I certainly don't. The equation doesn't even exist, actually. Yeah. But, okay, suppose it would have existed, then let's assume that only two people in the world would have understood it, Hilbert and Bartosz, let's say. Other Bartosz, of course. Then most people would not understand. But if you really understood the equation, you would also have reached understanding. The point is that you don't understand the equation, and therefore you don't reach understanding. But okay, anyway, the point I wanted to make here, and that's something which becomes even worse later, is that all those notions are closely intertwined. So theories about the relation between mind and brain have to do with theories of understanding, theories of what you expect from a good explanation. Has it to be based on causal laws? Can you also have other kinds of explanation? Are they satisfactory kinds of explanation? How do they relate to understanding? And that's where my reason for why I started to doubt, but it was closely connected. Sorry.
Yeah, I'm just
scared. Yes, sure. We have plenty of time.
Okay, I'm totally like a layperson in this topic, so it's a very simple question. But the legal imagination, it's like imagination that is applied by lawyers, right? Or is some specific quality?
No. I think it's an imagination which you use in basically in these two functions. Bartosz specified them, but I essentially agree with him. Sometimes you imagine is a case, and then you have...
Sorry? I have different functions.
No, yeah.
It's one of them. The other is the humanity function, which means that it serves that imagination or mental simulation helps to understand language.
Okay. Sorry.
So this is the one function, and the other is about language.
Okay, then I have to... Bartosz is not to be blamed. It's completely my fault.
So here you are saying consciously imagined states of affairs.
Yes. No, not things which happen to be a mental model in your mind, of which you are not aware. So it's something you try to imagine. Okay, what would you do? Somebody stole a bread, but she did so to save her children. Try to imagine the poverty of this poor woman. The despair when her children were hungry, she didn't sleep for many years, many nights, sorry, many years is deadly. her children were constantly crying. Can you imagine that? And finally, in despair, she stole a bread. Do you think she should be punished? And then most decent people would say, no, obviously not. And that's something which you immediately feel without producing elaborate arguments about grounds of justifications and all the theories which lawyers have developed to deal with this kind of cases. You start with your feeling, and of course you can develop later a theory why this feeling was justified, but the feeling is there first. And one way to do so is have a vivid imagination of what's going on, because then you can fully employ and deploy the nature of your legal intuition. That's one sense, and the other one is you try to imagine cases of variations on the case. You use your intuition for all those varied cases, and then you try to figure out what are the differences which explain the differences.
Okay, and how the status of this legal imagination, because I understand that you discuss status of this imagination in terms of legal process, whether the conclusions are valid.
No. What I'm trying to do is lawyers, including me, Jetsi, don't worry about it, have often the strong feeling that processes like this with the accompanying mental images play a role in your decision making, and typically they're also happy with that. So I think you think not only that it happens, you also think that's a good thing that this happens. And then my argument is, well, that is somewhat hard to reconcile with the physicalist image of brains producing new brain states, etc., and the role of this imagination as mental imagery, because how can mental imagery play a role in those causal processes? So this is, on the one hand, something which seems to be given. So that's the way we do it, and I agree with Jesse, I have that feeling too. And then we have this more theoretical approach with brain states and physical and causal laws, etc. I skip all the details because I don't know them either. And then those two seem very hard to reconcile. And then you have to do something. And one thing is, and there are some more findings from cognitive psychology, that people are not always aware of what makes them take particular decisions. which also seem to detract a little bit from this picture. And then what are we going to do with it? Are we going to stick to the physicalist approach and say, we believe this, and we have strong feelings about it, just like I also have the strong feeling that I take decisions, while theoretically I don't believe that. Are we going to skip this, or do we stick to it and then we have to do something else there? Either abandon the physicalist approach or do something about causation. Okay, I will skip abandoning the physicalist approach, not because I think that it's holy and sacred and cannot be challenged, it can be, but that's rather complicated and I don't see in this story a reason to do it, but maybe there are other reasons. I will go to the third option, that is a discussion about the nature of causation, because I've assumed a very simplistic notion of causation. I think it has to do with what you said about explanation. So I think what you told can be translated into a story about causation, so maybe we agree. So actually my first example is very similar to an example that you gave. If I gently push a vase, which is on the table, and the vase tumbles from the table and breaks, I'm quite certain that I caused the vase to break. So we have this strong idea that about causation. There is no regular connection, or the Humean term, vicinity, between the pushing and the breaking. Actually, there are lots of circumstances in which I push a vase and it doesn't break. Nevertheless, we still think that my pushing caused the vase to break. The pushing by itself, though, did not force the vase to break. This is a story of your fans. Okay, it was on the table, near the border of the table. It fell on the floor was hard, and then it was a collision, etc. We have a nice story. We don't even produce this story. We see immediately that you pushed the vase and you broke the vase. And only the rest is story afterwards. So we see, but I don't see any causal law here. We can try to break it down in small steps and try to find causal laws there, but actually I see that you break the vase and we don't need any causal laws for seeing that. So there is something there of causation which does not fit in the picture. Maybe causation is not what I assumed and what the physicalist paradigm, which by the way I didn't even specify, I just assumed, seems to assume about the nature of causation. Maybe causation is not found in nature at all. Although at some level of description there may be a regular law-like connections between facts of some times. The correlation, by the way, not the causation. It's not by accident that I formulated it that way. And there is a link between what you were telling. When you talk to lawyers, you know that there's a complete library of literature on the nature of causation. And when I was a law student long ago, I assumed that all those lawyers were stupid because, of course, physicists would have a far better idea of what causation is than lawyers, and this is all just confused talk, etc. I've grown a little bit older, and I hope wiser, although it's always doubtful. Anyway, I think that the lawyers perhaps are better theorists about what causation is than physicists. Causation is, I think, presently a matter of attribution. We point out to some event or some fact as the cause of it. And that's a mental affair. We do it somehow. And you can do psychological research in finding out when people attribute to something the status of the cause. Lawyers have done lots of case law research trying to find it out. There are a number of famous books on the topic about legal causation. There are lots of theories. Actually, from that literature, it turns out that you can have discussion about when you should attribute the nature of a cause to something, and that this process can be guided by rules. So it's not something which you discover in nature as people at the beginning thought. Actually, it's a matter of policy. Which kinds of things do we want to consider as the cause of that kind of damage? And what we actually also do is, and that's what Jerzy pointed out completely correctly, we do attribute mental states the nature, the status of a cause. We do talk about, why did you do that? Well, I wanted to do this, and I saw that doing this would be accomplished by doing that, belief-desire model, and therefore I did it. And we considered it also in psychological theories, somewhat primitive psychology, I guess, but nevertheless, in some kinds of psychology, we consider that to be a good explanation of why we acted. Why did you drink water? Well, I was thirsty. Okay, mental state. Also a bodily state, by the way, but also a mental state. And that explains why you did something. And we consider that as a cause. So maybe we should redefine the notion of a cause. And then you can have a different theory of causation, still to be specified in a lot of detail because we don't know it yet. And in that theory of causation, you can find an explanatory role for mental states. Okay, so I started from a particular theory of causation, a simplistic one, I admit. And then my conclusion was that if epiphenomenalism is true, which still seems quite an attractive theory to me, then mental states cannot play, as conscious states, cannot play any role in explanations of behavior or whatever, and therefore also legal imagination cannot play any role. But if we broaden the notion of causation, then there may be causal roles for mental states, but then we have to abandon the physicalist paradigm because not all causation is on the physical level. We have other kinds of causation. Then we can rescue the causal role of mental states. The problem is, if we do that, can we still have the kind of laws and connection between causes and effects which are possible on the level of physics? Or do we have to do the same as with narratives? Of course you can produce narratives as a way of explaining things, but then we have an explanation, the kind of understanding, which is much weaker than the explanation and the understanding that if you use the nomological deductive or the Hempel-Oppenheim model. So you can go two directions. You can have a relaxed notion of causation with a causal role for the mental states. But should we really be happy with that, or should we prefer the more rigid notion of physical sciences, where we can make, hopefully, at some moment, precise predictions of what people will do and corresponding precise explanations of what people have done? That's the dilemma with which I'm presently faced. I don't have a solution, and I'm very anxious to hear from you what you think about this. Thank you for your attention. Yeah.